My name is Eduardo, and I am a Community Events Manager at the amazing Modern Skills CROs. And thank you for joining us in the last event of the second day of our three-day Revenue Excellence Summit. That was a lot of numbers. If you're not familiar with MSP, you are 100% missing out, because Modern Sales Pros is the world's largest and highest quality community for those in sales management, sales leadership, sales and revenue operations, and sales enablement, aka our Modern Sales Pros. Our mission is to create an environment for our members to answer the toughest revenue questions out there. And if you're not a member yet, you will be invited to join after the summit. And I hope you will, because I would love to see you around in some of our events. This summit would not be possible without our amazing sponsors, who you see us. Thanks to them for making this happen and bring all this to you. This is a specific event, the 3 days and 17 total events of this summit. So very good job. Thank you very much for sponsoring. And to learn more about these innovative companies, click on the sponsors have made available just for us this week. And you agenda right here, right now, filled with opportunities for us to reimagine sales completely. Whether you're in sales, marketing, customer success, or product, there will be content for you. And we are about CROs, but first I want to go over some housekeeping notes. First of all, this event is being recorded, so you will be able to access all the knowledge that my panel will give to us today in a later day, so you don't miss out anything. Second, I will encourage you to familiarize yourself with GoCast so you can get the best experience that we are offering here. And finally, ask questions. My panel, we were talking on the backstage, they said they love questions, they love answering questions, and they love communicating with people in the chat. So please use the chat. And lastly, look at this amazing lineup of panelists. Mm-hmm. I am about to pass the mic to Melanie. She's the CEO at Sackett, and she will be hosting this talk today. Now, let's have some fun. Let's hear from Melanie. Melanie, the floor is yours.
Awesome. Hello, everyone. And let me know if you can hear me well. Might be having a little bit of issues here, but it is so great to be here. My name is Melanie Fillet. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Sackett. My background prior to Sackett was actually in RevOps enablement. So very familiar with working alongside CROs, seeing a lot of the growth challenges that come as you scale up. And so it's my pleasure to be here and talking to Matt, Derek, and Kevin. I'm, like I mentioned, the CEO of Sackett. Sackett is a modern just-in-time training solution. So what we do is we help reps find all the information they need to do their jobs by putting their training, sales playbooks, tool training, you name it, right front and center inside the applications they work every day. So with that, maybe Matt, you can go ahead and introduce yourself.
Sure. Thanks, Melanie. Appreciate it. Matt Garr, CRO at Spiff, where I lead sales, solutions engineering, and alliances. Spiff is the top customer-rated commission management platform on the market. I was going to say modern, but I think we're all pretty modern now, although we are one of the modern solutions, I'd say. Speaking of that word, we believe modern sales and finance teams deserve better than spreadsheets and old tech if they focus on driving visibility and transparency in their commission process. And that's what we do for a living. So we're in scale-up phase, which I think you'll see in a second, working on our path to 100 million. Prior to here, I've been in sales as a co-founder, $0 revenue technology company, up all the way through enterprise scale with a couple organizations. So a lot of fun experience and failure and successes to share with the group today. So happy to be here. Derek, let me kick it down to you if you don't mind.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks, Matt. So my name is Derek Sather. I am managing partner with Winning by Design. Winning by Design is a boutique consultancy firm focused at go-to-market. We really help organizations scale from that scale-up phase all the way through up into Series D, E, F. So for us, we are unique in the fact that we are all former operators as well. So we're not just consultants. We're people that have actually been in the seats. So I've been in Matt's seat. About not in Matt's actual seat, but in Matt's seat. And I deem myself as a recovering chief revenue officer, sat in a CRO seat for over 10 years over multiple companies. So I have the unique perspective of being an operator and actually being on the consulting side. So I get an opportunity to see, you know, 200 or 300 organizations per year. So with that, Kevin, over to you. And if you're talking, I can't hear you, Kevin.
How's that?
You're good. Yep, you're good.
You can hear me now? Okay.
Yep.
Everyone, and good afternoon. I'm Kevin Canarium. I'm the EVP and CRO at Clary. I joined the company 14 quarters ago. So if you're doing the math, that's closing in on 4 years. I've been a part of the journey from essentially joining, around the 10 million range to, as we approach the 100 million here. So I thought this topic was really fun for me. For those of you that, as you think about the role of the CRO, today I own everything from marketing to sales to customer success and support. So the go-to-market operations of the organization. For those of you that don't know what Clary does, we're a revenue platform. We help companies manage their most critical revenue process. Process, which is revenue. Companies like Matt's, of all scale, use us to bring all of their revenue critical employees together to bring collaboration and governance to those revenue processes. And at the end of the day, the goal, right, is to help them shore up revenue leak and get to really what we call revenue precision, that ability to hit and drive against a number in a predictable and repeatable way. This is my second CRO opportunity. The first was actually at a company that I joined pre-revenue called datascience.com, and we grew that to acquisition by Oracle. Prior to these two opportunities, I spent most of my career in really big companies, 11 years at SAP, 4 at Oracle, and prior to that, Siebel and Accenture. So I've enjoyed this world immensely.
Love it. Well, I'm really excited. It sounds like, Kevin, your experience is going to be great to bring to this conversation. So thank you all. And let's dive in. So first off, so in the conversation, we're going to be talking really about like every phase of a company's growth and really the evolving role of a CRO. But let's start at the very beginning. So let's start at that like early startup phase, like maybe not necessarily pre-revenue, but you're just getting a little bit of that revenue going. Like, what have you found? Maybe Matt, you can start here. What have you found to be the most important things to just focus on getting right as a sales leader in that stage of like, 0 to 1, or let's say 0 to 5 million in revenue?
Yep. Thanks for asking. So what I'll start with what I think is the answer. And it is just incremental deals, incremental net new customers, one at a time, every single month, every single quarter, whatever you can do to bring on meaningful revenue. And even it doesn't have to be the perfect deal, the perfect size, the perfect fit early on. I was with a friends and family funded bootstrap company at a pretty tough time, 07, 08. So it was during the second tech bubble for those that are dating themselves. But like I put my desk together type stage, actually came from IKEA and slapped it all together. A couple of pitfalls that we fell into, we focused too much on product early. We had a very solid alpha solution. It was ready to go to market. We were like, we got to use the $3 million we raised on a beta. It's got to be that much better for the customer. Well, I can tell you that was really ill-advised at the time. What we needed to do was really drive revenue through the platform we had, get enough initial revenue going. And I'm even talking, 30, 40, 50K MRR to get us to that $500,000 and upstage to where we could get some attention of more institutional and venture investors. So it was a tremendous time, ton of growth. But, I think we leaned in on product a little bit too much too early, where what we really needed to do is really really think about how we could bring on that first customer. This stage for us, I always liken it to, there's this cliff, and we would get 30, 40, 50 potential customers lining the cliff waiting for the first 3 to 5 to jump. And I think I should have spent a little bit more time on getting the 3 to 5 to get the 10 to 20 to jump. and a little bit less time on the product. So the little pitfall there in the early days.
I have so many thoughts, having been a founder that just, you know, went through that phase not too long ago. But I'm in the role of moderator today. So with that, Derek, maybe you can share just from your experience, you know, both from your past life or even, you know, observing companies, like what do you think is really important to get right at that stage? And what's the role of the CRO?
Yeah, and I can pick up a little bit on what Matt said, but I still lever back to a little bit of that defining product market fit. So you definitely need to continue to refine and iterate on that product market fit. But I think indirectly, what Matt's also saying is focus on your customer and the problem you solve for them and deeply understand why they're working with you and the problems that you continue to solve and what's that next tangential problem that may actually be your true product market fit. So you're doing the discovery, you're refining that product, but you're doing it in conjunction with solving real problems for your customer. And I think that side of it where you're learning and you are, in some cases, category creating, being close to those customers and finding that group of customers that are willing to invest in you as people and as company in order to help you accelerate that learning, that is really invaluable beyond anything else you can do at this stage, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that point you just said of like, hey, maybe that first idea or that first product you have is just solving a problem and potentially a big one, but you might uncover something much greater. Like that's definitely the experience we went through. And I think in a way, granted, I was our sales leader the first 2 years, so I was having those conversations myself. But I think what's really important at that stage that I think you're touching on, and Matt, you touched on a little bit, is that the role of the sales leader isn't just revenue. Like you're looking out for those opportunities to provide back to product and to provide back to the customer success team to figure out how to really just go after the biggest opportunity ahead of you. And so Kevin, I know you joined Clear, you said at 12 million, but before that you were pre-revenue. So what can you speak to from your experience as CRO early stage?
Yeah, Mel, it's obviously a little scary going pre-revenue. I joined a company that was in transition from mostly doing services work to actually creating a platform. And, you know, product market fit was huge in that. And the seller's job or even the head of seller CRO's job was to actually help with product market fit and understanding who would pay for what. You know, when you're in that situation and you're actually trying to build a sales team too, you know, you have to think about what is the kind of seller you're going to go attract to a company at that stage. They've got to be super entrepreneurial. And if you're selling something new that's never been on the market before, there isn't really a recruiter you go to find that person, right? So you kind of have to decide on what is the DNA of an early seller who's entrepreneurial. And I learned a lot there. The people I'd worked with in the past weren't going to live in this world. And I had to find a really good recruiter who could help me start to build my initial team. And then from there, I think a lot about, as we're talking about product market fit, you can put all of your eggs in one big company basket and start building for one company and get really sidetracked. And so learnings for me were actually finding a handful of companies that had some commonality that you could help your product and engineering teams build for, so that you could start to get to a repeatable process versus putting all eggs in one basket and building for maybe the biggest of whatever industry you were going after.
100%. And those horror stories, I think if you talk to most founders, like everyone's made that mistake sometimes to varying degrees. But I've heard those horror stories of like, you know, you take on that $1 million deal when you're probably only ready to take on a 100K deal. And then, you know, your next 2 years of a roadmap are trapped there. And next thing you know, after 2 years, they leave and go build their own thing. And so I think that call you made of just being really intentional with the kinds of customers you do bring on. And taking that, you know, more entrepreneurial look where, you know, hey, it's not just revenue right now that we're talking about. We're talking about, you know, potentially making a decision that would have a really, really big impact on where we go as a company is an important consideration for that sales leader early on.
Hey, Mel, one quick add here, just because I'm advising a couple businesses under right around 500K. And, you know, markets have shifted a little bit in the last few months for anyone raising money. I think we can all acknowledge right now. And it's just a bit of a hot take for those that are in that stage. When they were testing the market in January versus now, the ask was twice as much revenue, right? Like go back and make sure you prove the model that much more. and unfortunately at a lower valuation, of course, 6 months later. So it was just a good recent example of the importance when you're trying to raise money to start to scale your business, that your ability to show consistent growth on the, you know, on the ARR side early is simply the most important thing to do through everything that Karen, Kevin, Derek, and you mentioned, for what it's worth.
100%. Yeah. Go ahead, Derek.
Yeah, Matt, just thinking about that as well, is just looking at some of the things that we would normally look at, like NRR, and just saying, okay, how do we establish product market fit? And those customers that pay with us, but then renew and expand, are obviously something that would be someone funding the organization would look for. And but it's a little bit of a lagging metric. And starting to think about, and this is some of the advice that we're definitely giving, is what is your leading metric? So really starting to understand from a product-led growth perspective is, what is your usage? What is your usage frequency? How deep into the platform are they using it? Are they driving to that aha moment and building habits into a PLG motion? That's a little easier to talk about it as you're building that up, where you might not have that NRR data yet. But then I think that's, as founders, some of the things you need to think through, especially as you move up into go-to-market motions, where you might be starting in a PLG motion into a one or two stage sales organization. You need to start to think about that in terms of then saying, how do I really fit from a product market fit with a leading indicator? And that's how you start to drive some more awareness around funding.
100%. And I think, like, that, on that note, Matt, what you just talked about, like, hey, the environment has shifted, right? The requirements to raise have shifted. Early on for us, I am a founder. We raised our seed round in 2019. We actually had a hard time raising early on. And so we didn't have the luxury of lots of money in the bank. And so the first 2 years, like, we were frugal. We didn't raise our seed round until a year and a half in. So, you know, didn't take salaries, did the whole thing for 18 months. But I think that frugality and just, like, that mindset of, like, we are going to just go in and listen to the customer and not hire a sales leader too early, right? Because there is that mistake you can make as well, is, okay, if I just hire a sales leader, right, as the founder, CEO, I didn't have a background in sales. If I just hire a sales leader, they can sell the product. My problem goes away. There's a certain point that you need to get to before that can be true. And I think, like, this is forcing founders to get really, really clear on that, because every dollar counts. And you're going to have to be that much more intentional with where you place your investments from a demand gen, et cetera, because it's easy to spend money. It's hard to see the returns on it. And so while it's a tough environment, and I don't, you know, want to be in the position myself as a founder or CEO, ultimately, I think it is going to bring some good discipline to making sure that that revenue is really, really repeatable as we scale. So with that, so I definitely agree on that 0-1. So maybe, Kevin, you can talk about, as the company starts scaling, right? So you talked about hiring those first few reps that are a little bit more entrepreneurial. You've started kind of seeing those ingredients of repeatability. What are those metrics and leading indicators that you start paying attention to that you think are really important in that, like, next phase, right? So that, let's say, 1 to 10 million or so stage.
Yeah, I start looking at the data here, Melanie, and I start thinking about, okay, that first group of customers that we engaged with, how do I build a repeatable process around that ideal customer profile, right? So as we're thinking about industry segment, where in that segment, and then obviously becoming super important is the persona we're going to sell to, right? Because we're going to start to build all of our top of funnel content around that, right? So that we can start to feed this small sales team. We're going to have to build our enablement around selling to that particular persona. As we're now adding solution engineers, as we're now adding customer success managers who are there to support it. And, you know, our earlier conversation, we were talking about, you know, it's not just about the new logo, but it's about the expansion on the customer. And that actually becomes even more important right now. And so it's really starting to get those basics nailed down so that you can build the flywheel of how do you identify, attract, sell to, and retain, and then renew and expand customers. That foundational data becomes super important. And obviously in that is also you're feeding back into your product team the things that you now need them to start building so that you can scale up and build bigger and bigger teams to go after that business.
Absolutely. And you touch on personas, and I think this is a really important topic of conversation in that scale up phase. So do you recommend having, like, one persona that you're 100% focused on? Like, how do you really think about that in that phase? and how much of that plays into kind of the marketing efforts, the BDR efforts, et cetera? Because it's obviously the easy answer is one, but the reality is often in that phase, you're kind of testing out a few different things. So how do you think about driving that focus?
Yeah, so obviously at that phase, you don't have unlimited funds and resources, right? So I think it is really important to have a targeted persona that you're going after, and your message is going to be targeted against them, your enablement, et cetera. But we all know as sellers, it's not just the, in my world, the head of sales, Matt, that I'm selling to. Matt's got to get budget from the CFO. Matt might have to get approval from CEO. And so the enablement for us is making sure that our sellers know that there's a buying committee. And if they don't go beyond their primary persona, they're probably not going to get an opportunity. But I think it's really important to have that key persona nailed down. In my old world, it was interesting evolution that we went through. We were a company called datascience.com, selling a data science platform. And we started going after chief data officers. Well, funny thing happens, they may have a big title and a big company. Turns out they don't actually have big teams. They're sort of these islands of their own. And so we had to quickly pivot to line of business leaders who are responsible for a very particular process. So there's a learning curve you go through in identifying who your persona is. At Clary, we always knew our North Star, but that evolved a bit as well. Today, it's still that, you know, head of sales and CEO.
Super helpful. And so, Matt, maybe you can speak to, like, of all the metrics that you think are important during that scale up phase, like which ones do you focus on the most as CRO across, and I'll say across the entire revenue, so on the customer retention side as well.
If you had to pick. Well, go ahead.
If I had to pick three, going to be even more specific.
I guess the way I looked at this is you're starting to map out what your scale model is going to look like, meaning, you know, what does our velocity look like? What does our average deal size look like tied to the ICP we're focused on? So I think my big three, and they kind of remain into the next one, but they are velocity. So how long is it going to take? And that includes obviously conversion, top of funnel down. So what's that look like from top to bottom? Average deal size, ACV, depending on how you measure that as a business. And win rate, I think, kind of later, depending on what your competitive position is. I think, you know, maybe something not to focus on too much too early, because it could get you down, right? You got to remember you're at the 1 million to 10 million range. You're going to take your share of losses at that time. But I do think those are the two or three that I would start to measure, not just with an eye on optimizing them right away, because you're not at the scale to fully optimize them yet, but with an eye on, okay, where am I going to head so I can better understand my business? Then also, as you maybe diversify ICP, or if not ICP, you're at least getting into different segments or industries that act differently, then you start to measure the differences there. So you start to understand what your, you know, flywheel, as Kevin says, what it could look like over time. The only thing I'd accentuate here too is differentiation. By now you should really understand, and it's going to change a little bit, but you know who probably the legacy players are, you know what the do nothing looks like, you know what your evolving players are. If you're one of those, where do you fit in that? How do you differentiate today? And what's your I believe statement as a founding team, CEO, elite sales lead, on where you're going to take the customer that is going to be different than maybe where the incumbents are? And I think developing those messages and strategies along with some of these early metrics is pretty key in that phase to me.
Love that. And I think, Derek, you're in the business of helping companies figure out what those messages are. So maybe you can speak from your perspective what in that phase you think are the most important things to get right.
Yeah, what really resonated with me just now of Matt talking is really understanding a deeper segmentation of your customers. So figure out and don't look at averages, because I think that's the other side here that is a trap. So if I like take all of my business and I don't segment by SMB, mid-market, and enterprise, it gives me a false impression of where the true value and product market fit is, or go-to-market fit if we're talking maybe a little later stage. And being able to lean into those metrics, I would also look full funnel. So I would look from initial lead acquisition all the way through to raving advocate, to really understand where is the true value of our customers. What is that true ICP? I think if you're able to really understand that ICP plus the problem you solve for that ICP, and are able to really understand it deeply and how your tool and platform can impact it, I think that continues to iterate around messaging. But I think, as Matt said there, of being relentless around that focus and potential of the micro segments within your business to find those ones that are really significantly overperforming. Because I would say, look at your first 100 customers. There's probably 10 that are doing something magical that the other 90 aren't. Figure out what it is.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you raise a really good point. I think it's easy to define your ICP as who you want buying your product or who might be easier to sell to. But once you get to that stage, you know, you've got a little bit more data points around, like, well, which of your customers are really using it the way that you dreamed them to use it? And what does that tell you about, you know, how you can refine that? And I think those are some of the metrics around gross retention and stuff that start coming to life. Absolutely. And then so Kevin, just going back to you, in terms of the kinds of individuals that you look for at that stage, like, what would you say, you know, you talked about that entrepreneurial mind really early on, but when it comes to that scaling phase, which, you know, comes with a lot of different challenges along the way, like, what do you look for when you're hiring?
Yeah, it's interesting. I'm going to transition here because based on some of the things Mark said, to when I got to Clary, and we were really at a point where we were going from one type of seller and one type of engagement to multi-segment. So we're starting to specialize. And, you know, as you start to specialize, and maybe back up a bit, you know, we were selling a solution that I would consider, you know, not market awareness wasn't there yet. Category wasn't yet formed. And we've done a great job of building and creating and forming and owning that category. I'm proud of that. So I had to look for a couple things. The first thing I looked for in a seller was curiosity, meaning could they get to a Matt Gar and say, hey, Matt, how do you run your business? What's your go-to-market? What's your next few years look like? And help Matt understand that there is a better way to live his life by having something like Clary there to give him command of the business. And so there was really a missionary seller, right? So curiosity was number one. What I would call an acceleration mindset was number two. How do I help Matt figure out how to do business with Clary on Clary's time? And help Matt figure out how to actually buy something that might not have been a budgeted line item that he had the year before. And then finally, what I call a GM mindset. How do they act as a franchise owner of Clary, putting the right resources to work? So those were the three things we looked for. And I'll say, Melanie, that actually those three things are still the top three things we look for in our sellers. And they become more important in different segments today. So that was one was... you know, how we go figure out the right sellers for Clary too. As I think about segmentation and then specialization, you know, in that next phase, you're starting to figure out how do I get people to do repeatable jobs so that we can create, to Matt's earlier point, right? Our deals moving through the funnel at the rate we want them to do. Are we getting the ASPs we want? Are we getting the repeatability? You start to look at, well, do I have a hunter farmer model? Do I segment who goes after new logos and who supports the customer so that we can focus on expansion? So those all things now start to come in this phase at what I would call segmentation and specialization.
Love it. Absolutely. Well, great. So before we move up to a couple other stages in business, there's a couple questions here from the audience that I want to make sure that I ask. So yeah. One of them was really around sales team compensation models. And so Matt, given the space here that you're in, maybe you can start here. But one of the questions is like, basically, how does your sales team compensation model evolve between that like 1 to 5 stage? And then, you know, as you start scaling up from say 5 to 15 million, and what do you see, I guess, across your customers as well, being in that space?
Great question. I'm 2 months with Spiff, but I'm going to do my best to answer. And I've got a solutions architect somewhere saying you better not mess this up, but I'll speak from experience. I would say the earlier, the simpler it should be. And I also think, remember, when people jump on something early stage, there should be short-term upside. They're going to have the mid and long-term upside tied to equity, hopefully, if the organization focuses in that area. But I love the idea of a higher pay to play type outcome, meaning to translate it quite simply, higher commission rates in the early days to drive the, because it is so vital to get that first 50, then 100 customers. Let's you know, have that higher share of percentage early on, and really allow them to crush that. I've even seen, you know, if you're bootstrapping, scenarios where there's, you know, a retention package tied to equity payout. If you get us through this period and you're still here, or whenever you go, you know, I'm going to give you some love on the back end for taking a little bit less money up front because we don't necessarily have a ton of cash to spend. So I've seen some creative approaches to that. But I would say, you know, early on, just focus very much on that unit and maybe a higher rate. As you get into 5 to 15, there's this thing I've said before, you as a business, you want to start to do things that you'll thank yourself for in 2 to 3 years. So if you're at, you know, 10, 15 million, you're starting to think about future state metrics. You're starting to think about, you know, when I renew all 300 of these customers or whatever, okay, what's my opportunity there? Is there a price uplift opportunity? Does CAR matter? You know, contracted annual recurring revenue, where I want to do 2-year deals, 3-year deals. So I think as you scale up into that, you think about the metrics not only that are important right now, which will still be logo acquisition, obviously, but maybe you start to treat your commission plan and open it up a little bit to some other objectives that you know not only are good in the short term, but will be good for the business in the midterm. So that's what I would recommend adding as you get to that next scale.
Love it. Yeah, absolutely. And Derek, anything you'd add on either of those two points, knowing how many companies you've helped think through these problems, either on the compensation, and more than anything, because I think what Kevin is speaking to, like what to look for in candidates, right? And that sales team. And then Matt, like the compensation piece, incentives drive behavior. So how do you recommend, you know, just philosophically companies approaching that at that stage?
Yeah, and I totally agree with Matt. I think of having a higher compensation structure early stage makes tons of success, because think of the complexity that the seller has to do themselves. They need to do everything themselves. There's no infrastructure. It's basically, hey, go sell. That's really hard, as opposed to coming into an organization that may have 100 people supporting your sales cycle. That's going to be a lot. I mean, it's going to be different. It's going to be a little easier potentially, but you need someone very entrepreneurial. You need someone that's willing to do it all, that is has a strong bias for action, really helps to move deals faster, but then also get paid to do it. So it's high risk, but it's also high reward. So I think that is a special segment and type of seller that really thrives there. I would challenge, though, that same seller might not work in the 1,000-person sales organization, because now they got to play by the rules. Now they need to follow someone else's structure as opposed to the one they create themselves.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Such a great point. The scale, I had to just double click on that because, Derek, I couldn't agree more. We all deal with that evolution, right, of the org and the business metrics change, the rules change, and you have to make sure that, but I think if you're upfront from a leadership perspective, this is where we're headed, but I've absolutely seen organizations kind of hang on to that star $0 to $5 million rep that isn't necessarily ready for the scale, which means you're, you know, you can lead a team, you can move into this role, but we're going to do things differently now. You're going to involve more resources. We're going to do it differently. It's a great call out, Derek. You have to be with intent. You have to make those decisions and have those coaching conversations with your team to make sure they're ready for the next phase. Sorry, Melanie.
No, I love it. And definitely something top of mind. And also, like, how do you preserve that energy? Because there is a certain energy of those like early reps and the impact they have in your culture as you scale. So for sure. So maybe, Derek, one more question for you here from the audience. So one of the questions is, they're an SMB service company. And their goal is to start really scaling. And the question is, like, what are some of the attributes you think they should be looking for in a CRO, knowing that they may or may not have the opportunity to, like, you know, use a retained recruiter or something similar? Like, what would you be looking for?
Yeah, depending how early stage they are, I wouldn't hire a CRO at all. So it depends on defined CRO. So based on my definition, it's probably the wrong choice. I think what you need to do is hire a great director of sales, not even a VP of sales, depending on stage and growth, making sure that you're putting in a great coaching environment, that you're building a repeatable sales process. Yes, CROs can help with that, absolutely. But that's just one arrow in the quiver. And I would be afraid they'd overhire and take on a serious expense where the amount that CRO could impact the business isn't big enough to justify the spend. A great director of sales, though, that's a great hire. And start there, build out 4, 5, 6 reps, build out another director of sales, and then get a VP. And then once you actually establish that, then maybe a CRO makes sense. But timing is everything when you hire a CRO as well. And I think there are some stages and phases where a CRO might make sense pre-revenue, for sure. Generally speaking, I would say scale matters.
Yeah, absolutely. I love it. So let's start talking about scale then. Let's start talking about the grown-up phase, which is really that, I think we defined it as pre-IPO. So think Series D, E, et cetera. So maybe Kevin, you can take this one. Like, how did your role as CRO at Clary evolve as you guys went from that, you know, scale up to grown-up phase? Let's start with that.
Yes. So my role's evolved a lot since I joined. Today, I own marketing, sales, and customer success and support. It wasn't that way. When I got here, it was, you know, all the, it's just the core selling functions. And, you know, as you think about a SaaS company, right, you think about that continuous customer journey. And so one of the things you're really trying to do well is make all of these revenue critical employees work well together, common processes in support of the customer. And so as we evolved, the first sort of a move we made was when I got here, sellers sold and renewed and customer success also did renewal and supported adoption and expansion. And it wasn't a focused enough model. And once you've got, you know, 300 or so customers, you have to start to get them more focused. And from there, you're also trying to get scale and repeatability. So specialization becomes really important. The first thing we did is created new logo reps by segment. Second thing we did was move renewals away from CS and new logo reps into a new role we called account management that provided real focus on the customer. And then in teaming with CS, they're focused on adoption and retention. That allowed us to get two things, logo velocity and increase our target, which is net dollar retention, others call NNR. That allowed us to really start to, you know, manage what I call both of our funnels, funnel one and funnel two. That was key. And in building that AM team, it became pretty clear that I needed to drive alignment with customer success, services, and support. And the other thing we needed to do as we were scaling up was actually build a real services organization who had repeatable processes that, you know, we weren't just doing SOWs with new customers and doing everything forever, right? Without having defined entitlements and defined boxes. So that was a critical thing as well, so that we could, here's what we're going to sign up for, here's what we're going to deliver, here's the value you're going to get. And so we've had to mature sort of each of the supporting organizations that look after the continuous customer journey. And so it was almost a quarterly evolution, Melanie, of the go-to-market functions. You don't just start the year and have a whole new thing, right? You're gradually making adjustments as you go, and you're finding talent. The biggest, I think the thing I'm most proud of in the journey to scale was hiring people who were experts that could, that Clary could grow into versus them having to grow into Clary. They had a lot of headroom, right? So my leadership team has, you know, has evolved and come together, but most of them that are with me today as my directs, I hired not for what they were doing when they started with us, but what their potential was. And that was, for me, was a huge piece of this evolution, you know, to get us where we are today.
I love that. And to do that, you have to be a pretty great salesperson yourself, right? To hire leaders that, frankly, you know, the work, at least in the short term ahead of them, might be a little bit below their pay grade. So what do you think attracted those individuals to Clary at the time? Like, was it just kind of the long-term vision and potential and the potential equity? Like, how did you find those people that were willing to either take a step back or that hadn't fully realized their full potential that you were really willing to double down on and they were willing to take that bet on you?
Yeah, great question, Melanie. It's really, to me, it wasn't, you know, I don't think it was the equity. I think it was the story, the journey on what we had the opportunity to go and create. And in my world, also, you know, I'm creating a group of leaders and sellers. And their opportunity is to get to engage with other sales leaders and sellers. And so there's this virtual cycle that we have of learning from great companies and great go-to-market leaders, and then taking that and refining it and then giving it back and teaching. So that's, for me, a big selling point is the furthering of our chosen craft, which is sales. And so that was a big, I think, attraction for my team. Second was that ability to build something, right? The journey was we're going to be a big company that was making an impact, and that they could have an outsized role in the impact they were going to make.
100%. Yeah.
And so that equity and comp, I think we're all secondary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I see that. And I'm sure Matt and Derek, you've seen that as well, that there are certain people that just enjoy rough waters, right? And the journey of scale up, grown up, like, you become a better sailor because you like rough waters, but rough waters aren't for everyone. So I think being able to attract that kind of talent is key. And so maybe Matt, you can speak to, since you guys are on that path, like, what are some of those kinds of roles that you think as CRO really have that multiplying effect on your journey as you go through that growth?
Yeah, one thing is the journey. I actually learned this from a frontline AE in Brazil when we were opening Latin America, and he said the journey is the reward, which I think is such a key part of that early stage journey that, you know, in the short term, you might hit some tougher spots, but you're going to enjoy the outcome and the growth, to Kevin's point, that you can achieve through that period. And when you climb the mountain and you get there, there's just something exciting about it. There's something it's a different feeling, which is part of why I recently made the move from hundreds of millions, back into something that aspires to get to that level again. It's such an exciting time. So when I think of this stage, I still think, though, of continuing to drive in meaningful, significant, kind of logo expansion. Like when I was at Cornerstone in this stage, we, just the mid-market team, because I was kind of the player behind the player, so to speak. So I reported the CSO. And, we rattled off 3 million, 9 million, 16 million, 22 million in net new in 4 years, which now seems slow because that was a while ago. But at the time, that's 50 million. And we were one quarter of the team. Like, it was a huge vault. But what it uncovered, too, back to Derek's point, is we found all these other subsegments, verticals. We started to go into new geos like Latin America and Asia Pac, and just all these different markets to enter that really set the stage for us to get to that chart the course to the 500 million stage. The one couple things that come in that you start to think about are rules of engagement. I agree with Kevin on client sales or customer AE, or depending on what you want to call it, you get to 300. And just having done this most recently, when you hit a tougher period of time, imagine selling expense when there is no business travel. It wasn't the easiest time. We founded and propped up our client sales team and had tremendous results, right? Just tremendous outcomes, because, you can have same quarter bookings that you scare up quickly. You have a faster velocity, quicker win rates. And this all starts to get towards how you're valued as a business at this stage too. The people valuing businesses of this size are thinking more in terms of rule of 40, right? So maybe you're thinking rule of 20. You may not be ready to contribute. And we can call that a bad word, but even in the public markets and certainly in the private equity markets, once you get to the size of Kevin's at and beyond, you want to start thinking about, okay, how efficient is my revenue gain and revenue growth? And client sales, just to double down on that, Kevin, is a great way to get there at a lower investment level. So there's a couple things for you, Melanie. I hope I hit what you wanted.
Absolutely. And with that, Derek, you've worked with a lot of different CROs at this stage, because I think this is really you can speak on behalf of by design when they come in. But what have you seen as like kind of a common denominator across the CROs you've worked with at this stage that you think are like the most successful ones that you've worked with? Like what about them makes them so successful at that stage?
I think they kind of go across a number of different elements. I think what they're really looking to do is they're going to be very, very data driven for sure. So they're going to get a top line financial plan, and they're going to build the bottoms up model in order to, how do I actually get there? What are the resources? Where is the variance in the model? How do I meet it? How do I beat it? And then going back to Kevin and Clary, how do I forecast it and stay ahead of it, so I keep the executive team aligned on what the art of the possible is, and then what potentially those stretch goals could look like. I think then is you also need to build that repeatable revenue and stackable revenue units, if you will. So getting in place the turn-by-turn directions of how a seller sells, how a customer success agent runs customer support and runs an executive business review. Those turn-by-turn directions, again, helping you scale that new rep or new CSM to success faster. So ramp time is something that they're obsessive about. Looking in terms of productivity per rep. So you're looking at how do I get them up to a top line number? And that could be for really any role of what that productivity is. And then how do I increase that productivity over time, hitting some more of those efficiency metrics so that you're just getting better CAC LTV perspectives. The other thing that Kevin highlighted on was the importance of hiring. I'm often asked, what's the secret to scale? And I say people. And most people don't like that answer because they want something different. And unless you've gone through it, you don't really recognize how incredibly valuable your team and how you hire is. I would argue that's the number one thing. Everything else doesn't matter. Because if you're hiring great people, all the other stuff solves itself. So I think then leaning into what Kevin's done is it sounds like he's got a hiring playbook and a hiring strategy and building a hiring engine. As much as you're building a revenue engine, you need a hiring engine absolutely to scale. And then once you have those people in place, you also then need to build a career path for them. You need to keep them engaged, build that career ladder so they can start from that new college entrant all the way up to CRO one day. And maybe build that coaching culture and frameworks and enablement for your internal team in order to progress. And I think that's where you're then underlying everything that you do there, just measure everything so that you can then really understand, how do I become the best place to work, the best coaching environment, the best place for sellers and customer success and marketers to go? And then again, back on Kevin's point, you're going to have an A team that's really going to thrive. And it's around intrinsic motivation. It's not about money anymore.
Derek, one quick thing you mentioned that I think is important. I heard this recently from our chief people officer, our, you know, kind of micro paths. So, you know, you're not necessarily going to double in size, 200 employees to 400 each year. So it's ensuring at this stage that you're starting to create developmental paths that may, you know, it could be, you know, level one, level two, level three. It could be, you know, at your core, you start here, but then I expect you to grow these competencies or behaviors, or, you know, that you're able to grow that. And here's how to get there. But it's a very good point. Especially the modern employee coming into the workforce desires that development and that, and see that career path growth. And it may not be just a promotion in 6 months, but you have to create those micro paths that allow them to feel like they're not only contributing, but growing throughout the process structurally too. So totally agree with you there.
Can I jump on that one for a sec too? That for me, when we were able to create the career path from SDR, which we call RDRs, to emerging reps, to commercial, to mid-market, to enterprise, for me, that was the greatest accomplishment of my almost four years at Clary. Why? Because I could now hire, you know, people with the right qualities, train them in our Revenue Academy and progress them through their career. Where in the past, you know, it took a couple of years, you know, I'd have these great RDRs and they'd have to go somewhere else to continue in their career. And yep. When you can create that machine that creates great reps, and then through experience and mentorship, they can move to the next role, then you're creating your farm teams. But you think about each segment has different velocity and learnings. And if you can take the things that reps are really good at in those early segments and get them to enterprise with that same level of hustle and pipe build, then you can have a pretty cool machine. The other thing that was really important for us too, as we scaled out, is all of my first line leaders were reps here, right? So they knew the job, they knew the solution, they knew how to enable, and that was key to us. Sorry, I'm getting over COVID. That was key to us to scale up over the last couple of years.
Yeah, that's a really, really great point. The frontline sales managers, I think not enough people people do that, but we've recently promoted one of ours and see a lot of value there too. That's great. And so on that same note, you mentioned something, Derek, you talked about playbooks and you talked about enablement. So maybe you can speak to like, what are the components or elements of enablement that you think are the most important to get right to tackle those metrics around ramp time and efficiency, et cetera, at that scale where profitability and efficiency are really becoming the most important?
Well, I would take it really easy because I go with the generic answer is, yeah, you need an end-to-end playbook, but I would start small. So build an amazing discovery process. So if you build an amazing discovery process, it again solves so much downstream problems that if you nail that and do that in a best-in-class form, it will save you an incredible amount of time and energy. So how do you do that? You do it in a modern way so that you're talking, you know your ICP, you know your persona, you know their use case, and then starting to ask questions in a really specific order around situation, pain, and impact, really trying to figure out how your solution to their problem can really make their lives better and the companies they work with more money or save money or a better user experience. Some of the tools that I've seen work really, really well is those question-based guides, and we internally at Winning by Design call them cue cards or question cards, is what's the exact question I should ask in this order and being able to get to a point where I can have great dynamic conversations. The trick here, though, is it's not a script. It's a cue card if you are an actor and you're looking at what's my line? Oh, right. And then I'm back on having a great conversation. I think that really matters so that you're really using the power of story and the power of question in order to drive a really strong engagement. Ask great questions, tell good customer stories, and I think generally be curious in terms of how you can help. And if you're starting to programize that and build that into a playbook, you're really starting to understand what's all the research I need to do to before I have a call with this customer. Who are they? What do they do? What's the persona? What's the use case? And then what are customers just like them that have gone through this exact same transformation, have used the product? I want to be able to tell their story. And then come back in and do that discovery call in a new light where you're advising and consulting as opposed to talking about your future functions. I think that's one just good example of the initial steps that you can make in order to develop great stackable revenue of taking someone to be able to sell in a really common methodology in a common manner.
Love that. Well, thank you for that answer. So we've got 5 minutes here, and I thought, Matt, you alluded earlier to this environment being a little bit different. Maybe we can close out here by just getting any advice that each of you have for a sales leader or CRO, you know, regardless of the stage they're in, because I think, you know, at the end of the day, some of these things are stage agnostic, right? Like, what are you all focusing on in terms of the factors that you can control, the metrics that you can control? And what would you recommend to a sales leader out there that either is in that startup phase or even later, really double down on in an environment that's, you know, has this level of uncertainty? And maybe Matt, you can kick us off and I'll pass on to Kevin and then Derek.
Yeah, sure. This is part of why I'm really excited to have jumped over to the sales tech stack side of the house for what's worth. Because I think that if you contemplate the solution sets we bring to market, Speckit, Clary, Spiff, certainly, it ties back to revenue efficiency, and continuing to drive revenue outcomes for the business. And I think no matter what the environment is, you can't save your way to prosperity. And I think that our customers, prospects, the whole market has to understand that. You certainly can become more capital efficient. You can reduce costs in certain areas. But I would say, you know, again, if you've got the financial model to allow you, the last thing I would recommend doing is cutting too hard on the acquisition revenue growth side of the house. Because like any cycle, it will bounce back. And, you know, you see a lot of organizations doing it preemptively. You see a lot of organizations using this as an opportunity to sit tight or even invest in revenue growth. So I think the tidbit I'd throw out at folks is, how do you tie your solution to positive revenue, profitability, break-even type outcomes within these organizations? So it just doesn't seem like some cost that I don't need to invest in. So that's one thought anyway.
Love it.
Yeah, I'll jump on that from Matt. You know, I'm spending a lot of my time right now with our customer CROs and our prospect CROs, and we're all having the same conversations. What are you seeing? what's your company asking you for? What's your board asking you for? And what are you going to do about it? And so what I'm thinking about, you know, how I can be helpful in this situation is thinking through what are the key indicators, right? I call them leading indicators, that it's our responsibility as CROs to help guide the company in its ability to make decisions. Those are strategic decisions. Those are cost reduction decisions. Those are redeployment of resources and areas that are working versus areas that aren't. And so, you know, thinking through what are the key leading indicators of health impact, et cetera, on your business, and being able to have a way to put those in process, to measure those, and to drive those right all the way down all, you know, your full hierarchy of revenue folks. And so that's what I'm spending, honestly, a ton of my time doing right now for our own company and for our customers and prospects.
Love that. And then before passing on to Derek, on that same note, like, what is the advice you're giving your reps? Like, how are you keeping their energy? You know, because whether or not your business is directly impacted, the news is out there, right? Today, inflation came out. Like, there's all these signals, whether or not they're directly impacting you or not. Like, how are you kind of keeping that energy up? And what is your kind of advice to your sales professionals on your team in terms of how, you know, what they can control in their cycle?
I'll jump in first there. Luckily for Spiff, our pipeline growth has not been impacted. On the contrary, it's actually up and to the right. So I think we all know that any sales executive's mindset is well positively fed by pipeline. I'm not saying we have so many that we were throwing deals out, but it's heading in the right direction. So I'm focused on that and ensuring that my team understands that. And in addition to that, focusing on how we can help companies retain and grow their revenue during the tougher times. And if you continue to remind them and have that mindset and confidence going in, you know, you're helping even in the era of something that might be a little bit scary for some companies.
I'll double down on what Matt said there, right? Is what I'm working with my reps on is they're in a position to help both prospects and customers in a very critical time. And, you know, obviously we've got a solution that is, you know, very well matched for critical times. And then two, it's one, there's good they can do. And two, you know, there's an opportunity to learn a lot as you go through this kind of a cycle. You know, if you're a student of revenue, right? We learned a lot going through COVID. We're learning a lot going through this. And you also have to do things to keep them really focused, right? And you have to create programs and plays and incentives to focus them on the behavior you want during this kind of environment. And then so they can go in their commission system, which ours is Spiff, and see how great they're doing against their targets.
Love it. Love it. And Derek, you're working with a few different customers. What are you seeing them adjust right now with this environment?
Yeah, I think it is a really strong push towards sustainable growth. So it's no longer grow at all costs by any means. So it is definitely that it is right-sizing the team, optimizing for quota attainment, really looking at what's the right sales capacity to carry. So a lot of the modeling that Kevin's talking about, I think, is table stakes and just needs to be done. I think also an increase of focus on existing customers and looking at some of the tactics that you could deploy there, as well as tactics from a marketing standpoint, too, is really looking at potentially reducing your aperture of what an MQL definition would be so that you're getting higher and higher quality leads. So your win rates go up, quota attainment goes up, and your marketing spend goes down. So there is some other things, but your growth rate's going to slow. So it is right sizing that for the market to make sure that you're really driving to that sustainable growth, but you're retaining as much of the company as you can for when that growth opportunity is again, where you can hit the gas.
Absolutely. Well, Kevin, Matt, Derek, thank you so much. Matt, I know you got to run straight into the meeting here. But really enjoyed the conversation. Hopefully all of those of you that listened in got some great knowledge from these experts here today. And please feel free to connect with all of us on LinkedIn for any questions that went unanswered.
Awesome. Thank you very much. Can everyone hear me? Good?
Yep, we got you.
Thank you very much, panelists. This was really awesome. Melanie, you were an excellent moderator. Matt, Derek and Kevin, you're excellent speakers. Matt, you're free to go. You can go. I'm just going to say a few words, go to your meeting. thank you everyone for joining us today. We're so pumped to have you here. And this was the last event of the summit for today. But if you like it, and I'm sure you did because of the chat and all the questions coming up, we have more events coming up tomorrow. So see this agenda here. And we have 3 in-person events, which is amazing. We have in-person events in New York City, Austin, and San Francisco tomorrow. So if you are in one of those 3 cities, please send us a message and we will send you an invitation for the event. Starting up tomorrow, we have Adding Fuel to the Fire. That's going to be our first panel tomorrow. So make sure you come back tomorrow and listen to this conversation. But let's focus on this one today. While the panelists and I hang out backstage, the MSP team will make sure to add all the recordings and the key takeaways to our website. And you will also receive a follow-up email with all the information that you need. Panelists, thank you again for joining me here today. I'm sure the audience really enjoyed hearing from you. Let's hang out backstage. Awesome. Bye, everyone. See you.